I actually bought one of Intel's goofy new CPUs. And no, it's not to make fun of it or to ritualistically sacrifice the thing, but I think this Intel Core Ultra Mega i75 or whatever it's called is the best value video editing CPU you can buy today. Now, obviously, there are a bunch of caveats to that statement, but before we get into that, a word from today's video sponsor. Have you ever run into this problem?
I can't get a new cable in there. I'm gonna have to take the power supply out like some kind of animal.
Well then, today's video sponsor, the Corsair Shift RMX power supply, is for you. By shifting the power supply connectors from the front to the side of the power supply, it makes cable management way easier. And the fact that it's attached to a high-quality Cybernetics gold-rated power supply is the cherry on top. So get yourself a Corsair RMX Shift Series power supply with the link down below. This is the resurrected husk of the system that I've been editing on for the last 3.5 years. And I say resurrected because I recently had a borderline catastrophic failure. While working on a video, I dropped another M.2 drive into it to get some data off it, which killed the motherboard, like super dead. It was so dead that it didn't react to any power going into it. In fact, I was convinced it was the power supply that died, but no, it was the motherboard. Then, stricken with panic, mid-video project, I had to cobble this system together, which still has the same 12900K in it. Luckily, the motherboard managed to save every other component in the system, including the storage and stuff, which I was very happy about. That would have been a complete disaster. The thing is though, I do think maybe a little bit of damage did happen, because inconsistently, this system is very unstable. Initially, for the first week or so, it took about 5 attempts for it to boot every time. It felt like I was trying to start an old lawnmower. However, that's kind of fixed itself. It boots first try 90% of the time now. The thing is though, I'm worried that at some point over the next 3 months, when the system's lulled me into a false sense of security, it's just gonna die mid-project again. So that's why I'm upgrading to the new Intel Ultra Core 9 Ultra Ultra. I wanna replace the core components in the system so that I lull myself into a false sense of security. So with that, let's have a look at the new CPU and discuss why I am the only person in the world that's actually ended up buying one. Now, first off, in terms of motherboard, Asus sent over this ProArt Z890 Creator, which has a couple of features about it that's really interesting to me. Now, aside from this awesome M.2 heatsink implementation that hides 4 M.2 slots, not including the one up here, that's amazing, but it's got 3 Thunderbolt ports on the back, which I can definitely use. Now, the inclusion of 10 gigabit Ethernet is also interesting, but I'm not sure I'm gonna use it because in my experience, onboard 10 gigabit Ethernet implementation is usually pretty butt cheeks. Now, the reason that I went with a Core Mega CPU and a 7 nonetheless is entirely because of Puget Systems' Adobe Premiere Pro benchmark. Now, according to their testing, Intel still remains at the top of the pile when it comes specifically to Premiere Pro. I mean, this thing might get absolutely smoked in gaming by X3D chips, but in Premiere Pro, apparently it's still got the edge. And in the test where they compared the Mega 9 and the Mega 7, there was a very small performance delta between the two. It was only about 6%, which, considering the fact that there is a 60% cost difference between the two CPUs, value-wise, I just couldn't justify not getting the 7. However, just after I bought the 7, I went back onto Puget Systems' website where I found a different set of data. I guess it updates based on the Premiere Pro version because that's kind of how the benchmark works, and I think the performance metrics change quite a lot per version. And here, not only did AMD manage to claw back a bit of a lead on their admittedly more expensive chip, but the performance delta is also bigger between the Ultra 9 and Ultra 7. Although 13% more performance as opposed to 6 is hardly titillating. So in terms of value, I think the i7 is still a complete beast for this use case. But I'll do my own testing once I've assembled the system so that I can see where our configuration lies. Now, there's also the side issue of, Dawid, why are you using Premiere Pro? Isn't Adobe the company equivalent of Pol Pot? And that is a fair point, random Gary. But the problem is, despite my burning hatred of Premiere Pro, I know how to use it and deal with its many, many problems. And video editing software has a massive learning curve to it. And considering how tight my production schedule is, I just don't feel like I have time to embark on that long, soul-crushing journey. We'll see how long it lasts, probably just till the next time Adobe murders a bunch of puppies. We'll see how it goes. But that leaves me with Premiere Pro and this terrible little Intel Ultra CPU. So let's assemble the system and see how it performs. I then decided to test fit a different graphics card I wanted to use, which we'll talk more about later, but considering that all modern graphics cards roleplay as Los Angeles class submarines, the graphics card wouldn't fit with the radiator mounted in the front, so I also had to do something about that. Now with the ProArt motherboard, I have a little bit of an issue because there seems to be a miscommunication between SSD and motherboard manufacturers. The two SSDs that I had in the previous system both have heatsinks on, whereas on the ProArt motherboard, the actual heatsink shield is like built into the motherboard, so it's not compatible with this kind of heatsink. Now it's fine for the top one because I can just not use the heatsink, but the heatsink is kind of built into the motherboard down here. So because of the thermal pad under here and that bit of heatsink, it doesn't even close in it. You see, this is an issue that I've had with motherboards and SSDs for the last couple of years, and it's always really annoying. Yeah, I feel like they just shouldn't put heatsinks on M.2 drives because all motherboards have heatsinks on. Or like have it separate in the box or something. Whoa, look at how bent that M.2 drive is. Another problem with these shields is that you can't access your SSDs with any PCIe cards. Oh no, the motherboard VRM heatsink is blocking our 280mm radiator, so I'm gonna have to use a smaller AIO here. Okay, let's hope it works. Okay, that's a good sign. Hey, there we go, it's running. So now that we have our system up and running, let's see what result we have to beat. Now for this testing, I downloaded Puget System's Premiere Pro benchmark, and with our starting system that has the 12900K and the 4060 in it, this was the score I got. However, this was with the RAM running at 4800MHz, which is the configuration I was using because of the previously mentioned lawnmower instability incident. Luckily, for this round of testing, I could also get a run done with the RAM at 6000MHz, which had a massive impact on the performance, definitely not within the margin of error. So now that we've got our baseline reading, it's time to see how much more performance we got going with the new Intel CPU, and the result is, it's basically the same. With the 4060 in here, it's not really made a difference. Now, in all fairness, I didn't do this upgrade for performance, I did it for potential reliability issues, but it's still pretty disappointing to see that our results are so far into the depths of the loser end of the Puget Bench bell curve. But don't worry, we haven't updated the BIOS yet. Maybe we get some more performance doing that. Oh, I mean, it's a little bit better, but no, it's still basically the same. But maybe we can use some more aggressive overclocking settings in the BIOS to get us to that performance we were expecting. No, that's also not made a difference, has it? But maybe the issue is our placeholder RTX 4060 in the system. Now what I'm gonna do next, which is probably gonna be a huge mistake because I've had a bunch of stability issues with this RTX 5070, but I'm gonna drop that into the system because Nvidia has added a bunch of like H.265 encoding features and stuff like that to the 50 series cards, which should actually help. If this is too unstable though, I will try an Intel GPU instead because they can do the same thing.
Oh, wow, that's made a massive difference. So clearly with the previous configuration, we were GPU bottlenecked in this benchmark. That is much more like it, and hopefully we don't have too bad stability issues with the 5070. I mean, I've edited most of the video up until this point on this system now, and I haven't had any issues so far, which is kind of promising. Now, just for another point of reference, I did also run the same benchmark on my system at home, which has a 7950 X3D and an RX 9070 with a 9070 XT BIOS on it. And that system loses us about 1,000 points in this benchmark. But remember, the 7950 X3D had pretty big sacrifices in terms of productivity performance, which the 9 series X3D chips don't seem to have. But either way, the results of these much more expensive chips really puts the value proposition of the i7 into perspective. But either way, there we go, it does seem like there's one very niche use case where Intel isn't a terrible choice at the moment. And on that bombshell, thank you very much for watching. Like and subscribe if you want to see more videos like this one, and until the next one, bye-bye.